So I'm going to talk about what the truckload market looks like and why that's important. Then I want to answer why are truckload, or how are these services procured and the rates set, because that kind of sets the stage for trying to predict them. I'll talk about how you can forecast truckload rates. It's kind of a loaded question. And then I'll talk briefly about areas of future research. The thing to remember for truckload operations is that it's like a taxi cab as opposed to a bus. A taxi cab. So you might pick up a load in Reno, take it to Rapid City, South Dakota, drive empty to Denver, pick up another load, and so forth. It's important to note that both drivers and carriers only get paid for the loaded portions. They don't get paid for those empty miles. Now, if you're a private sector, you have a private fleet like Walmart, that driver gets paid because they're on salary, right? But typically, for hire transportation, you're only getting paid for those loaded miles. Contract rates are very different than spot rates, and that's what causes all the problem in transportation and trying to forecast. So contract rates set in advance for long term, usually a year at a time, they're set. They do not change. Spot rates, on the other hand, are at the time of tender. So, and they're for one load, not for multiples. The contract rates are non-binding. What do I mean there? Anyone who's been in procurement gets baffled when we talk about truckload transportation because they don't have to accept every load. They're expected to, but there's, I don't know of any company besides some inbound for manufacturing where they will penalize a carrier for turning down a load. Usually you have an acceptable bound, 90%, 95% acceptance ratio. Spot rates are binding because they're accepting that load and they're going right away. And then the other thing is that 80 to 95% of the volume moves by contract. It's really pretty the dominant mode. The challenge here is that each of these rates are set by contract, by a different auction from those carriers to a different shipper. So what am I going to predict? Do I predict the average? Do I predict the median? Do I predict the range? This is the challenge. And so there's more going on than just a single market rate. This is why there's variability for contract rates. And so let's talk about neural networks. And so there's a bunch of different types out here. I'm just going to talk about artificial neural networks and some recurrent ones. There's a handful of articles and people have done it in the literature for different modes. Some people have done this for ocean. We're looking at it for truck, but we're trying to see. It's growing, though, because people can run machine learning algorithms at a push of a button now, so why not use them? And so there's a great race right now to be able to do better prediction in the short term. And so this is being widely used now, or trying to be used in pilots for spot. And so what I've been doing over the last years, some initial studies to see, does it make sense? Does it work in my domain, which is trucking? We've been looking at this for a bunch of different things. I had a student, she went and looked at this, trying to predict the next 7 days on a lane and do a rolling forecast. And we're trying to figure out, should I do one big forecast for the previous year and then predict 7 days? Should I have a rolling where it takes the last seven to predict the next seven? Do I do the last 3 weeks to predict the next seven? All these sort of things. And the results were okay. And so they differed depending on if I'm trying to forecast spot or contract rates. I actually had her do a comparison of ARIMA, one of those time series, versus some more sophisticated neural networks. And they were pretty comparable to each other in the short term. Future research, we're looking at four areas. How can I use neural networks to forecast in the short term, 1 to 4 weeks? It doesn't make sense to use this method forecasting a year out. It just doesn't. Some other questions, though. Contracting methods. Everything I said about that non-binding contract, does that make sense? Are there different ways? We're talking to different shippers on this because there's a lot of interest right now in the market. One of the things is index-based rates. If I set an index like the Baltic Sea index, and you just set rates, but they change based on the index that I give, that's one way to look at it. Maybe there's index rates that I can introduce. Guaranteed volume contracts. So there might be a way to treat it like a portfolio, right? So I have certain things that are guaranteed volume. So if I look at the volume on a lane, it goes like this. Maybe I can carve out a piece of that, and I will pay the carrier whether the load shows up or not, but they've got to give me a lower rate. The third is electronic logging devices. You guys are the experts here. But what's the opportunity? Everyone looks at the penalties and the costs and the downsides. That's what the press focuses on. But there's a lot of opportunities here. I've got real-time time location data on my drivers, on my loads. How can I leverage that? Many shippers are very interested in understanding how they can mine that data. Last one is the rise of the Uber effect. There actually is an Uber freight. One of our alums, Bill Dreger, is the director of that. And what's interesting, we have this ongoing conversation. And his claim is that just like Uber disrupted the taxi business, that could also happen on the trucking side. It's interesting to see what's going to happen there and how that will change.